Hello guys, just a Friday video did not come out and it feels so long that we haven't interacted. But then let's keep all of these aside. I have already apologized for the Friday video, and moreover, it wasn't about that I wasn't consistent. It was other issues that came up, the network issues that came up, and I will try my best to accommodate in the next Friday video. So keeping aside all of the things, let's start with the leftover portions of our NCERT class 7. The fifth chapter, like the first chapter of the video, is water, and we'll start with the water. There's a front page about all the introduction and everything, the major sources of the fresh water, and what is terrarium, which is an artificial enclosure for keeping small house plants. And this is important because the freshwater lakes, you know, it seems like that. Then you have a small map thing, and trust me, if you go through the map in all the NCERTs, your maps get solved easily. So we look into all the small things that are here, the genuine, the main ones that is present here, so that when we go further and revise it in a better position at that time, that'll be a revision to us. So first, when we look at North America, you'll find the Great Bear Lake, the Great Slave Lake, Lake Winnipeg, Lake Superior, Lake Huron, look at Salt Lake City, look at Mississippi River, and this Mississippi River has been in news at a lot of time. The Caribbean Sea is at the small portion there, and just look at all the major things that is present here. When we now come to South America, this is Amazon River, and about Amazon River, it's there in our NCERT only, and we'll be completing that in this video itself. So Amazon River is a major portion that is there in South America. Just look at the South Atlantic Ocean, which is there, and there is Tropic of Capricorn passing through South America, and then Africa, and then Australia also. So all of these becomes important. Then when you look at Asia, you have the Caspian Sea, you have the Brahmaputra River, the Ganga River, the Wango, you know, the Arabian Sea, Bay of Bengal is very common there, South China Sea, East China Sea, and the Tropic of Cancer passing through what all countries and everything. When you look at Africa, there's Nile River, the Egypt famous for, Niger River, Congo River, Orange River, Lake Victoria, and do know that Lake Victoria is the biggest lake there that passes through three states and things like that. And after that, we have the Black Sea, the Caspian Sea was of Asia and Europe, but Black Sea is Europe, Danube River is there, Mediterranean Sea is there. The Australia, Darling River is the main river, the Coral Sea thing is there. So basically what I want to do is, when you look through the map, the next time when you come across some river, you'll at least have this in mind that yes, I saw it there. Then there's a small portion here which is nothing important, but then you could just go through that, the distribution of water bodies, which is very common. In the ocean circulation comes the important parts, the waves, the tides, and the currents. Waves are basically the water on the surface of the ocean rises and falls alternately, and this movement is called waves, and the stronger the wind blows, the larger is the wave. Then tides, the rhythmic rise fall of ocean water twice in a day is what we call as tides, and we have two types of tides, the spring tides and the neap tide. When the sun, the moon, and the earth is in the straight line, we call it the spring tide. When it's in the same line and the highest tide is called then the neap is when moon is above the earth. Also, the quarter position is there, and that is like the lowest tide or the low tides that we see. Then we have the uses of tides. You know, they help in navigation, they raise water level close to shores, they helps ships to arrive at the harbor, move easily, helps in fishing, rise and fall, useful in generating electricity. Ocean current, stream of water flowing constantly on ocean surface in definite direction. That's what ocean current is. Then we have the map. If somehow you get this map in your atlas, just have it, you know, sticked around somewhere where you visualize it every day, and you can, because this is important. And right now also you can pause the video, go through all these currents, because the warm currents, the cold currents, everything is important. UPSC might just ask, consider one of the river, let's say the North Atlantic Drift, and might just ask, consider the current statements about this. It is a cold current? No, that's warm. So your answer gets wrong. Now let's come to the answers. See, this is the beauty of answers. Like, for example, we did not look into precipitation because we basically know about this because this is class 7 book. But then we do need to write the proper answer to this because we might just miss out on something. So the phenomenon of water falling back onto the surface of the earth, maybe in the form of rain, snow or sleet, is called precipitation. The second question is, what is water cycle? Okay, that's easy. But then, process by which water continuously changes its form, circulates between oceans, atmosphere and land. What are the factors affecting the height of the waves? That's speed of the wind, the earthquake, volcanic eruptions, underwater slides. These are all marked. If you want, you can go back to the video and refer to that. But if we spend this much of time in class 7, it is really not worth it. So that is why I want to move fast, fast and faster. Which factors affect the movement of ocean water? Its temperature, gravitational pull, warm and cold currents, winds. What are tides and how are they caused? We've already discussed the rhythmic rise and fall of the ocean water. And tides are caused by the gravitational force exerted by the sun and the moon on the earth's surface. What are ocean currents? Stream of water flowing constantly on the ocean surface in a definite direction is ocean currents. Also, we have the give reasons. Ocean water is salty because it contains a large amount of salt dissolved in it, and the salt present is mostly sodium chloride or the common salt that we consume. Quality of water is deteriorating. Deforestation, garbage, chemicals, everything. That's the issues. The increased use of fertilizers, pesticides, all of the things basically you write about is that yes, it's deteriorating because of the human activities. Then we have the tick, the correct answer. Process by which water continuously changes its form and circulates between oceans, atmosphere and land. Which of the option is correct? The correct answer is water cycle. Generally, the warm ocean currents originate near equator. Rhythmic rise and fall of the ocean, okay, tide. And then match the following. We have Caspian Sea, the largest lake. Tide is the periodic rise and fall of water. Tsunami, strong seismic waves, and ocean currents are streams of water moving along definite paths. Now, the fun activity is something that I would suggest you to do at least for this one, because see, once you complete the A to J part and then if you look at the carry-on detective part, the part 2, you will find that with the help of an atlas, draw each river which you discovered in from whatever the part 1 said. So, once you go through all of these, once you figure out what all are the rivers, after that you can mark it on your map and somehow you will know about, you know, you will relate to a lot of rivers and things will become clear for you, but accordingly just know the time limit also. Then we have chapter 6, the natural vegetation and wildlife, and in this, the first page again, we have all those small basic concepts. The one important from this is that growth of vegetation depends on temperature, moisture, slope and thickness of soil, and accordingly it will become easier for us to, you know, bring out or point out which temperate grasslands or which type of shrubs or trees or anything which is found at what place, and accordingly we can proceed. This is types of vegetation. Please do this. Let's do now. Generally classified into three broad categories, that's forest, grasslands and shrubs. And in that grasslands we'll have the temperate, tropical and thorny. So first, when you look at forest, you have that, yes, they get the temperature, the rainfall is plenty there. Now you have the types also, the tropical evergreen type that you're just seeing right now. Just go through them, read through this, because tropical evergreen is something that they receive the highest rainfall throughout the year, and that is why you have the beautiful plants. The species is very, very rich there. Then the anaconda, the small portions, do you know, just go through them, just don't leave it out. Then you have the tropical deciduous forest. You then also have the temperate deciduous forest, the temperate evergreen forest, and with this you have the coniferous forest that will just come right there, and then the Mediterranean vegetation. And with this you will have the all small details about that. If you want, you can pause them, read them, because once you do this you will just have an idea of what it is, because these things will come back again and again and again. Grasslands, it's the moderate rain that you get there, and this is basically divided into tropical, temperate and thorny, which you can pause the video, look over it, or just, you know, keep it aside or make it sure, the small notes, and you can be done with that. Now we come to the answer the following questions. Two factors on which the growth of vegetation mostly depends: temperature, moisture. Three broad categories of natural vegetation: forest, grassland, shrubs. One line for each and you're done. Two hardwood trees commonly found in tropical evergreen forests, and this is why these NCRT becomes important, because you need to mention all of these and you need to keep note of what all species, what all trees or fruits or plants, anything that's mentioned there, because you will not even know how UPSC just asks. So, two hardwood trees are rosewood and mahogany. And which part of the world are tropical deciduous forests found? They are known as monsoon forest and include India, Northern Australia, America. In which climatic conditions are citrus fruits cultivated? So these are actually UPSC questions. I'm telling you, these are map-based questions that UPSC does ask. So citrus fruits are grown in regions marked for hot, dry summers and mild, rainy winters. These citrus fruits include oranges, figs, olives and grapes. Mention the uses of coniferous forests. They make matchboxes, good packing boxes, and used for making pulp, used to manufacture paper, newsprint, etc. World seasonal grassland found. So, which part is it's found? In the mid-latitudinal zone and in the interior parts of the continent. Now, we come to the correct answer. Mosses and lichens are found in tundra vegetation. So, this is another way UPSC might ask you questions. Thorny bushes are found in hot and dry desert climate. Tropical evergreen forest. One of the common animals is monkey. One important variety of coniferous forest is pine. Steep grassland is found in Central Asia. Then we have matched the following. Walrus is a polar animal. Cedar are softwood tree. Olives are citrus food. Elephants an animal of tropical deciduous forest. Campos, tropical grassland of Brazil. And downs is temperate grassland in Australia. Then we have give reasons. Animals in polar region have thick fur and thick skin because to protect themselves from the cold climate conditions, or region has limited natural vegetation due to its cold climate. And tropical deciduous trees shed their leaves in the dry season because they experience seasonal changes, and hence the tropical deciduous trees shed their leaves. Then type and thickness of vegetation changes from place to place because of the change in climatic condition, landform, temperature and moisture. The soil, all four things that depends, I mean the vegetation that depends on them, that's all the four reasons. And different types of plants and animals can survive in different types of vegetation, that's like very practicality. Then we come to chapter 7, human environment, settlement, transport and communication, and these are the three topics that we'll study. So basically we have the small settlements. What are settlements? Places where people build their homes. Two types, permanent, temporary. Permanent is people build homes to live in. Temporary is short time, leaf forest and everything. Like they have the hot and cold mountains, they practice hunting there, gathering, shifting cultivation, transhumans also. So what do we actually mean by transhumans? There's a small box there and that's the definition here. Transhuman, seasonal movement of people. And then we have the villages or the rural settlements. So basically all these settlements are divided into rural, urban, compact and the scattered things. So rural, villages, agriculture, fishing, forestry, craftsy, trading, mill houses according to the environment. Urban is the towns are small, cities are large, manufacturing, trading, services. And compact is closely built area, and scattered is over extensive area. The hilly forest, extreme climate is there. That is why people do not settle there. Then we have the transport, in which means by which people and goods move. This we have. The first is roadways. Now focus on, do you know part the national and the state highways, and make sure that you know all the national highways also, because UPSC does ask this. Short distance, metalled, unmetalled and underground roads, it's called the subway. These are the only important things from here. Then we have railways, it's for long distance things, for heavy goods, and it has cheap rates. And this, like, you know, our railway network is the largest in Asia. But if you've gone through current affairs, you will know that it's largest, but it still does not suffice. And it's way back than Germany or USA and other comparative places. And Trans-Siberian Railway is the longest railway system. In Russia it is. And then we come to waterways. Waterways is inland long distance. Then sea routes also there. Also heavy goods, cheap rates is the same there. Navigable rivers, lakes, Ganga, Brahmaputra is used in transporting merchandise connected with ports. Singapore and Mumbai, these also are connected. So waterways is that. Airways is the fastest, most, best, expensive. Remote and distant areas cannot be fetched from here, but helicopters can be used during calamities. So airways is also important, and development in all of these is important. And then we have the small portion communication. It's the process of conveying messages to others. The modes could be newspaper, radio, television, that's called mass media. Satellites are there. Satellites have helped oil exploration. They've helped the survey of forests. We have internet, which is like you give all the world information. The interaction is available. And phones are also there, and from satellites, you know, you can have the mineral wealth detected, the weather forecast, as you know, disaster warning, underground, water, and everything can be known. Now let's look into the back questions. Four means of transport: roadways, railways, waterways, airways. What do you mean by the term settlement? Places where human beings build their homes. And earlier human beings lived in forests and caves, but with time advancement, we are now moving towards permanent settlements basically. So which are the activities practiced by the rural people? We went through that, the agriculture, fishing, forestry, crafts, work, trading, etc. And then mentioned any two merits of railways. Yes, heavy goods can be transported and also the cheaper means of transport. What do you understand by communication? Right now we discussed process of conveying messages to others. Technology has helped us discover fast means of communication, and telephones, mobiles, you basically have to just write about things. What is mass media? Different means of communication have brought about an information revolution in the country, and like we have the newspaper, radio, television, as we discussed. Then we have to tick the correct answer. Not a means of communication, table, type of road constructed under the ground, subways, mode of transport most suitable to reach an island, ship, vehicle does not pollute the environment, that's cycle. And now we have matched the following. Once we have internet, that's a means of communication, canal route, D, inland waterway, urban areas, A, areas where people are engaged in manufacturing, trade and services, compact settlement, we have closely built area of houses, B. Give reasons, today's world is shrinking because of the better means of transportation, communication, people are communicating with anyone across the world and can cover long distances within the shorter period of time, but this has enabled people to get into contact, but this has also made the world miserable, and that is why today's world is shrinking. But it's not just about the miserableness, you have to write about, yes, the world is shrinking, the world is coming down because now we have broadened our reach, widened our reach, and we can, you know, reach anywhere in this world. Now we come to the Amazon, as we discussed that we'll be doing that in this very video. Amazon is in the equatorial region, and why was it named Amazon is in the do you know portion, and if you know it without reading, do write it down in the comments. Then we have a small portion called tributaries. What is tributaries? An Amazon basin is the largest river basin in the world that you need to know. Then we come to the climate. What is the climate of the Amazon basin? Stretches directly on equator, hot and wet climate throughout the year, day and night, hot, humid, rains every day, and that's like the climate thing. Rainforest, the thick forest due to rain, so it does not allow sunlight to reach the ground, remains dark and deep. Orchids, bromeliads, no grow as plant parasites. It's rich in fauna, and all the types of birds are also mentioned here. Animals are mentioned here, and you just have to know about it. People of the rainforest, the men hunt, women take care of crops, grow tapioca, pineapple, sweet potato, and the staple food, manioc, also known as cassava, eat queen ant, egg sacs. And then we have the rainforests again of the Amazon basin, and from this you need to know that yes, there's a large apartment like houses called Maloka, and they live there. Now we come to life in the Ganga Brahmaputra basin. Just like it was Amazon there, it is Ganga Brahmaputra, and it's a customized knowledge of all of these life in this basin. So here you'll know that yes, this basin has a varied topography and subtropical region. It's the Ganga there, Brahmaputra there, so plains of Ganga, Brahmaputra, mountains in the foothills of Himalaya, Sundarbans, everything is there, that's called features. And the tributaries of Ganga you need to know, tributaries of Brahmaputra you need to know, where do they flow, where do they drain, everything. Just know about these because UPSC might just analytically ask you anywhere, and what are the wildlife, everything, just know, because if there's something that they know, or maybe elephants are found, this particular type of elephants are found in some particular type of call it the conservation, the wildlife sanctuary, so UPSC might just ask you from where is it. So this was it with the life in the Ganga Brahmaputra basin, and now we come to the back questions. Name the continent in which the Amazon basin is located. We already discussed this in the starting of the video, that's South America. Crops grown by the people of the Amazon basin, tapioca, pineapple, sweet potato. Birds that you're likely to find in the rainforest of the Amazon, toucans, hummingbirds, birds of paradise with the brilliantly colored plumage. Now make sure that you note all of these down on your copy or anywhere that you can, or maybe just note it down from the chapters, because mark it in the chapters, because these do come, you know, you don't even realize how, but they are in the paper, and then you'll regret that, yeah, it was just in the NCRT. Major cities located on the river Ganga, Allahabad, Kanpur, Varanasi, Lucknow, Patna, Kolkata. One horned rhinoceros is found, where is it? In the Ganga Brahmaputra lane, so it's in just the Brahmaputra plain. So now, take the correct answer. Toucans are a type of birds. Manioc is the staple food of Amazon. Kolkata is located on the river Hooghly. Deodars and firs are a type of coniferous trees. And Bengal tiger is found in the delta area. Match the following. Cotton textile, F. Varanasi, Maloka, D. Slanting roof, Pirhana, G. Fish, silkworm, C. Sericulture in Kaziranga, A. Assam. give reasons the rainforests are depleting because of the large-scale development, industrial activities, deforestation, topsoil of land is getting washed away, decreasing the soil fertility, trees are unable to grow, so rainforests are depleting. Paddy is grown in the Ganga Brahmaputra lane, yes, because the cultivation of paddy requires sufficient water for growth and so it can only grow in areas of high rainfall. Again, map skills, do not miss out, do whatever they are asking you, and for fun, yes, you can miss out on this part, but then make sure you note down the wildlife sanctuaries and everything. Now the last topic for today, life in the deserts. We have two portions, the hot desert Sahara and the cold desert Ladakh. The first thing, yes, low rainfall, scanty rainfall and things like that. The hot desert Sahara, you have all the basic features about it. Basically, it touches 11 countries. Now, do remember these: Algeria, Chad, Egypt, Libya, Mali, Mauritania, Morocco, Niger, Sudan, Tunisia, and Western Sahara, all in Africa. The location is there in the map. So, make sure that you remember these. You do not miss out on these. And, if somehow Sahara is in news for any reason that you might just, start with. UPSC might just ask you about Chad or about just Niger, and maybe they might just give you choose the correct statements, whether this is a landlocked country or anything like that. So just make sure that you know everything about all of the map pointing things. Then we come to climate: scorching hot, parched, dry, short rainy season, sky cloudless, clear, nights freezing cold, temperature maybe near 0 degree. Vegetation: cactus, date palms, acacia, camels, hyenas, jackals, foxes and scorpions are the animals there. Now the next portion that we are looking in is the people, the Bedouins and Tuaregs. These are the two tribes that they've talked of, and these are the nomadic tribes, and what they do, they do rearing of livestock. They provide them with milk. The livestock provides them with milk. The hides are used by them. The hair is also used by them for the animals and everything. And they wear heavy robes as protection. Osus in Sahara supports for water. Grow date palms, rice, wheat, barley. So basically all of these are the occupation that they do. And accordingly they proceed with the things there. Then we have the cold desert Ladakh, lying in Great Himalayas, east side of Jammu and Kashmir, known as Karakoram Range, south of Zanskar Mountain, so location is important. Then we have the Gangri Glacier is found here, altitude is high, varies, the climate is cold and dry, so it varies there. Willows and poplars are the species that are found there. Summers, apples, apricots and walnuts grow. The birds thing that they have is robins, red starts, Tibetan, snowcock, raven, hooper. So make sure that you note these down, because these might just be asked and you wouldn't even realize when and how it just went away. People, either Muslims or Buddhists, and the famous monasteries, whatever are there, just make sure summer, what all things are grown there, the barley, potato, peas, turnips, beans, everything like that. Now let's look into the last questions for today. Two types of deserts found in the world, hot and cold. Which continent is Sahara Desert located? Covers a large part of North Africa, so Africa. Climatic conditions of the Ladakh Desert: cold desert, lies in the Great Himalayas. Altitude is high, because of which climate is very cold. Air very thin, intensifies the heat from the sun. Temperature in winter is less than minus 40 degrees Celsius. Day temperature in summers is just above 0 degrees. So you can write all of these about the temperature and climate. Mainly attracts tourists to Ladakh. What are the features? So because Ladakh is visited every year, so this question is asked. The main attractions are the Buddhist monasteries, gompas, enjoy trekking, meadows, glaciers are there, the witnesses, and these ceremonies, festivals, and all of these are something that the tourist sector enjoys. What type of clothes the people of the Sahara Desert wear? Heavy robes as protection against dust storms and winds. Trees that grow in Ladakh: apple, apricot, and all of these are already discussed. Take the correct answer. Sahara is located in northern Africa. Sahara is what type of desert? Hot. Ladakh is mainly inhabited by Muslims and Buddhists. Deserts are characterized by a scanty vegetation. Hemis in the Ladakh is a famous monastery. Egypt is famous for growing cotton. Match the following: Oasis, D, depressions with water, Bedouins, F, Sahara, oil, A, Libya. 4. Gangri is C, glacier. Lamayuru is B, monastery. Give reasons: there is scanty vegetation in the desert because the desert is an area characterized by low rainfall, scanty vegetation because climatic conditions are not suitable for the growth of plants. So scanty vegetation again. People of the Sahara Desert wear heavy robes, already discussed in the answer round, that because they save themselves from the dust storms, the dry winds, because it's scorching hot and the wind is dry. Give reasons is over. Map scales again: Sahara Desert, 4 countries around it. Just make sure that you follow this. On the outline map, mark the Karakoram Range, Zanskar Range, Ladakh, Zorzilla Pass, and accordingly complete all the passes eventually. So you complete geography, and with that you also complete your the map pointing things. Alright guys, this was it with the video today. We finally completed class 7 NCERT, which was not big but then huge, I don't know how. Class 8 NCERT would soon come up and let me see whether we jump to another subject before coming back to geography. But this is the whole gist that I wanted to give you for NCERT. We meet next on Wednesday. Until then, keep studying. Thank you for watching.